We're now joined by economist and former NEDA Secretary Solita Winnie Monsod. Professor Monsod, good morning to you.
Morning, Karen. Good morning to all our viewers.
All right. I want first your general reaction. The Senate version was passed Wednesday morning. They excluded the SSS and GSIS as sources of the funds. Your thoughts first, generally.
Well, I understand that there is a provision in that bill which allows GSIS and SSS to invest, government corporations. Have they removed that amendment?
All right. So the Senate, the latest version that I've read is yes, the Senate explicitly banned investments coming from the SSS, GSIS, PhilHealth, Pag-ibig, OWA, and the Philippine Veterans Office.
Land Bank at the DBP, wala.
Pag-ibig po, wala rin. Based on what I'm reading po, because it was passed this morning.
Yeah, they passed it in such a hurry, the public never had a chance to look at it. And that scares me. Because, mm-hmm. We're talking about a sovereign wealth fund. This is not a sovereign wealth fund because I cannot see that it comes from government surpluses because we have no government surplus. It does not come from balance of payment surplus because we don't have a balance of payment surplus. Where is the source of funds? That's what Senator Aimee Marcos asked herself, and still she voted for the bill. I don't understand. She said, what is the source of funds? If, unless we find that question, how can you call it a sovereign wealth fund? It is not. It's some sort of investment fund na I don't know. Parang the government is trying to compete with the rest of the investment funds and pension funds in the Philippines. Mm-hmm. I cannot, up to now, mm-hmm. I cannot really locate this fund in terms of all the other funds we have in the Philippines. Aimee herself said, kung ang pinapag-usapan natin may proyekto, lahat naman yung mga proyekto niyan, may fondo yan. Mm-hmm. So what is the value added? Mm-hmm. I'm quoting Aimee Marcos. What is the value added of the sovereign wealth fund? And I cannot answer that question. I don't think there's any value added, and there is a danger. Karen, have you talked in any of your interviews about the first MDB, Malaysian Development?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah.
This is a 14-year-old sovereign wealth fund. The Philippines is modeling itself after the INA, which is the Indonesian sovereign wealth fund. But that Indonesian fund is only 2 years old. We don't know what's going to happen to it. Now, the Malaysian Development Bank, Malaysian Development Berhad, is a sovereign fund which started in 2010 or 2009, and it is now a shell, and all its assets and its debts have been taken over by the Finance Ministry of Malaysia. So what do you think is going to happen to our fund?
Okay. I want to take on from some of the things you said. I'll start first with Senator Aimee Marcos brought up good questions when it comes to the Maharlika Investment Fund, and yet she still voted for it. Are you disappointed with the fact that in the Senate, frankly speaking, several senators brought up certain issues? You have senators asking to remove the Banco Central ng Pilipinas dividends as a funding source. It was rejected by Senator Mark Villar, the sponsor and the author. The question is, do you feel that the senators didn't stand up against the fund as much as they were speaking about their concerns?
Karen, this Senate, you can see 19 voted for it. My goodness, I don't even know whether half of them know what it's all about. Really. But I have heard, and I mean, the television, the television news that I get is that this is a necessary condition for Miguel Zubiri to be reelected again. He has to pass this before the break. If that is the case, then this is a strictly political move, not an economic move on the part of the senators. Now, yes, and we are hoping that any fund that we get, a sovereign wealth fund, a truly sovereign wealth fund, will be economically helpful, because that's what they're touting. It's for economic development, etc. But they do not show the relationship. Mm-hmm. Because you have the Philippine Development Plan. You have all the projects, mm-hmm. all the investment projects that are needed for that Philippine Development Plan, and they supposedly have funding or will have funding from abroad or whatever. Mm-hmm. So what are the other projects that they're talking about? Mm-hmm. What are the other projects that they say, you know, we need this for the other projects? What are the other projects? Mm-hmm. Those are going to be, you know, the unnecessary projects, yung mga, you know, for show projects, like mm-hmm. like the many projects that we had under the Marcos regime, which were totally unproductive.
Okay.
In that case, we are going to end up with another ruin, another financial disaster.
All right. Some points about the fund, just to balance this out. The Senate says they've put in enough safeguards to ensure, of course, that the fund will not be a repeat of something similar to what Malaysia experienced. But let's move forward from that. Let's move forward from that. I want to ask you, ma'am, madam.
Senators?
I'm sorry?
I said, do you believe the senators? Have you seen? Mm-hmm. Have you seen what they have put in? Mm-hmm. I have not.
Yes, so
I
yes.
Say, but I will not take their word for it.
Mm-mm. Now, the lower house and the Senate is still yet to meet, mm-hmm. and they will discuss and come out with one version. In the House version, the SSS, GSIS, pension funds are in the House version. And this means that the Senate version is not the final version. What are your concerns, Professor? Because it looks like this is going to happen. The fund is going to happen.
Well, the fund is going to happen, that is for sure, because President Marcos, you know, put his stamp on it and talked about it in Switzerland, etc. I'm worried about what is going to happen to the Philippines as a result of that fund. And I am saying that fund can go, maybe it can go, you know, the good way, but it can also go the Malaysian way, where, you know, the fund was destroyed, the prime minister went to jail, the prime minister's wife, I mean, is going to jail. I don't know, but that cannot happen in the Philippines, no? The Marcos has stolen so much money from the Philippines, and none of them went to jail. The prime minister, Najib, whatever his name was, he's going to jail or is already in jail, and his wife is already in jail. That can happen. That can happen to our fund. They went to jail because there was corruption. There was all sorts of exploitation of that fund from the powers that be, the government.
Hmm.
We don't want that to happen here in the Philippines. And I really do not know, Karen, if there are safeguards against it. Because, you know, when you talk about not allowing SSS and GSIS, I don't know how they can go around that. We are so, what we call it, our government officials are so good at getting around things. Mm. I'm truly afraid
Okay. All right. Now, if the Maharlika Fund becomes law, this will clearly outlast President Marcos Jr. So when we speak of safeguards and safety, it should be for all government officials regarding abusing the fund. That's one. But I wanted to ask you some issues here specifically. Among the changes of the bill, the Senate version, because none of us have seen it, is there was a proposal to disqualify from the board of directors any person who within 5 years before being appointed has a pending administrative or judicial case relating to fraud, plunder, corrupt practices, money laundering, tax evasion, or similar crimes, etc. So the Senate put in certain safeguards regarding the appointees. What kind of safeguard would you want, Professor? If the bill is going to pass anyway, what would you want as a safeguard?
Well, that the president or the head of the state does not have anything to do with the appointment of the officials in that. It has some sort of a, you know, some sort of a head hunting operation, and it should be, I think, done by people whose integrity and whose competence are beyond reproach. I don't want any politician to get involved in the appointment of this, because if this is truly an economic development fund, which they say it's going to be, and it's truly not going to be using surpluses, which obviously is false, because central bank dividends are part of what goes to the national treasury for use in the budget. So when you use central bank dividends for this fund, you are essentially removing the central bank dividends for use in other development projects of the Philippine Development Plan. It's already a conflict there, all right? So I don't know how you can repair it, but wala kang magagawa talaga ka. You appoint, for example, the appointees. I want those appointees not to have been in the government, you know, for the past 3 years, for example. In other words, I don't want the senator, the finance secretary Diokno, to be at all part of that fund.
But then he would be. He probably would be.
Well, if I want that fund to be with clean hands, everybody. I have a safeguard for clean hands. Pero hindi mangyayari yan eh. Here is Secretary Diokno pushing for that fund. If he is going to benefit from that fund, I don't want that to happen. If you benefit from that fund, in other words, if you're going to be the head, apparently have the salaries been changed?
It's not been released yet. Oh. I mean, but the salaries will be that of the private sector. But in other countries, Professor Monson, the finance secretary is part of the board.
Oh, well, part of the board, okay. But and after he's finance secretary, he's going to still be there.
Okay, so let's move on to certain. Okay, so you've made that point in terms of personalities who may benefit or who may have an interest in the fund. I want to ask you this. When President Marcos Jr. certified the fund as urgent, in his certification, he cited certain factors. He cited global inflation, the economic consequences of the Ukraine-Russia conflict, the continuing interest rate hikes in the international financial sector. He said these are compelling grounds to tag the fund as urgent. So,
you know, the president should read the Philippine Development Plan. because the development plan takes all those into consideration. You know, and they have a Philippine development plan, they have a public investment program. I mean, what is the role of the Philippine development plan and the public investment program in all of this? I mean, in other words, is this a replacement or is this fund for things other than what is in the Philippine development plan? If it is for things other than Philippine development plan, we should be very, very cautious, because those investment programs under the Philippine development plan are what are considered necessary and important. So if you take, if you're going to fund other things, nakakatakot yun. That's like funding, you know, the palace in the sky, or funding, you know, you don't know what they're funding.
Okay, now, in terms of what they're funding, Speaker Martin Romualdez has said that once the corporation is created, the Maharlika Investment Fund will look to the Philippine Stock Exchange in search for blue chip investment opportunities from which they say handsome dividends are created. So what was striking here is the fund will look to the PSE on where to invest. What do you, what are your thoughts?
You know, this fund is supposed to be a commercial fund.
Yeah.
It is supposed to raise money. You know, it's supposed to invest in things, you know, in projects that are infrastructure projects. I mean, if it's a sovereign wealth fund, infrastructure projects, including human infrastructure, health and education projects, because this fund is supposed to replace whatever whatever rents are gotten from natural resources and minerals that are non-renewable. In other words, a sovereign wealth fund is supposed to be there to ensure that the future generations are going to have as much, or if not more, than the present generation as far as resources are concerned. Except that a sovereign wealth fund transforms the wealth from the natural resources that are non-renewable to other types of resources, human resources and infrastructure. That is the role of a sovereign wealth fund. That is the original role of the sovereign wealth fund. It is definitely for development, no question about it. But what projects are these funds going to finance? If they are going to finance what is in the Philippine Development Plan, fine. But you know, this fund, what is this? What are they doing? They're going to invest in blue chip stocks? What will that contribute to development? What they're trying to do in investing in blue chip stocks is supposedly to make a profit higher than the profit that the other government agencies, government financial institutions cannot make. I don't understand it. Medyo confused sila eh. And here they are, Martin Romualdez is confused. I mean, talking about the stock exchange, etc. Where are we going? That, you know, from one confused person to another confused person to a confused public. Is that the way to pass a law? Why didn't they make it transparent to everybody so that everybody could find out what is going on? You know, now it's such a well-guarded secret because they just want to pass it. Isn't that terrible?
Ideally, Professor, let's have an overview. Ideally speaking, a sovereign wealth fund should come from surpluses. Ideally, so that's one. But ideally, where should it be invested in? Because sovereign wealth funds today are losing money, right? You have Norway, which is the biggest. It lost billions of dollars in the first quarter of the year. Singapore Wealth Fund lost also the beginning of the year. So the sovereign wealth funds are doing very well all over the world. So ideally, where should this be invested?
The original sovereign wealth funds, which have been, like the Kuwait Investment Fund, I think Saudi Arabia has it, was to invest the rents from their oil and their gas into one infrastructure that will contribute to economic growth and development, physical infrastructure, and then to human capital infrastructure, to the education and health of their citizens, so that their citizens will become more productive and will because human capital is the largest portion of the wealth of any country. And that's what they're supposed to be doing. That's where the funds are supposed to be going. The funds are not supposed to make money in other, the funds are supposed to be invested, not to be speculated on to make money on whatever these new funds are doing it on. Mm-mm. What we need is investment in made infrastructure, in physical infrastructure, and in human capital, because those are the resources that are, that will compensate for the loss of the renewable resources that the country is using.
Okay.
The perfect source for any investment, sovereign wealth fund that we have, is the Malampaya. But what happened to Malampaya? They took it away from Chevron and Shell. They gave it to Udena and Razon. And Udena and Razon are going to get other contractors to dig for oil or gas or whatever, So the profits from those funds should have been gone to the government, who will then create the fund to transform these profits into infrastructure and into human capital that will ensure the growth of the wealth and income of the country. That's what a sovereign fund is for. Now, what has happened is that the stock market, the capital markets have gotten involved in this fund, and I don't know where they're investing it in. Where they're investing it in, they want to make more money, but the fact is, what is important is that they improve the resources in their countries.
Actually, you make an interesting point there, that the irony is the Malampaya, the proceeds, the profit from Malampaya would have been a stronger source for the sovereign wealth fund if it was brought back to government. That's pretty, actually, it seems commonsensical.
That's what the original sovereign wealth funds were doing.
Yeah.
They were getting the rents from their non-renewable resources.
Yeah, yeah.
Transforming it into other forms of capital. That's what the sovereign wealth fund is. And that money is a surplus because it comes from,
So it's a natural resource. It's underground.
Where is the other source? The mining. But we have such a lousy mining law that the government gets only 5%, I think. The government owns the land, the minerals.
Yeah, yeah.
And gets total about 5%. It's what we should do is look into that. Certain congressmen are involved, the mining industry is involved, the president's cousins are involved. Nothing will happen. So where are they getting the funds from? They're getting the funds from dividends from the central bank, from the Banco Central, which are really going to the government anyway. Mm-mm. You know what I mean? Terrible.
So the target now, Professor, is, I'm curious if you've been ever used as a resource person in the Senate or in the House in the formation of this fund? Were you ever used as a resource?
Absolutely not. I was asked for the constitutional change, but I've never been asked for the Maharlika Boy.
Okay, so because you've given really interesting points today. So the target right now has been increased to 500 billion pesos. I believe that's what I read. I could be wrong. I could be corrected right now, but that's the report I've seen from Sherry Ann Torres yesterday. So what is the effect if the fund loses money? What is the effect to the Filipino people? Because if the fund is coming from the BSP dividends, and if at some point there's a clause, and then the SSS, GSIS, because Wick Velasco really supports this fund. So most likely in the final version, the GSIS, they may put a window that the GSIS can choose to invest in the Maharlika Fund. Yes.
And you think that choice is going to be a voluntary choice?
If the Senate version is it bans it, and then the House version is it's a source, a practical middle ground could be that the agencies can choose.
Yes.
Right?
But you see, Karen, you see the illogic of the falseness in logic, because they can choose. What do you choose? The head of the GSIS is appointed by the president, as is all the board of directors. Do you think their choice will be voluntary? But this is what happened to GSIS and SSS. GSIS during the Marcos regime. It got bled dry. And the central bank, our central bank, really went bankrupt during the Marcos regime, because it was saving all these projects and saving all the banks that had financed these projects. And it is itself, we don't remember that anymore. This happened late 1980s. History teaches us, and we never look back to see what has happened. And now, because of the Malaysia development on the sovereign fund, they're teaching us another lesson. Well, the Malaysians learned from the Marcoses.
All right. Now, Professor, just to balance this conversation, because yes, absolutely. This is your personal point of view, but I'll get two more questions in. Number one, if the sovereign wealth fund fails, what is the effect on the Filipino people? Is it just higher taxes, a bigger loan? What can happen? Because this was pointed out by Mr. Gunigundo earlier.
Of course, if it fails, who's going to pick up the pieces? The Ministry of Finance. Remember that Sovereign Wealth Fund is a government-owned corporation. Mm-hmm. If it fails, the government has to pick it up. That means the government has to take over all its debts and whatever assets that it has left. And when the government does that, who pays? Where does the government get its money? From the people. So we are going to pay for that.
All right. My last question now is, let's put it in context. And President Marcos Jr. believes in the fund. Without mentioning his father and what has happened in the past, there could be a possibility that the intention is really the best for the fund and the belief that the fund could help the economy. If that is the case, in other words, give President Marcos Jr. here a fresh perspective and a point of view on his own leadership. What is your message to him, Professor?
President Marcos, please do your homework. Find out what a sovereign wealth fund is supposed to do. Don't get, distracted by all this talk about extra funds for development, etc. They're not going to come. And at this point, what you are doing with the sovereign wealth fund is you are creating a, you know, an institution which could fail. And when that fails, the burden is going to be felt by the Filipino people. If the institution is not created properly, if there is no transparency in its creation, if it's a discussion between congressmen and senators, etc., where will the, you know, the people, please remember that the people are the ones funding it. It is not you, it is not the Senate, it is not the Congress, it's the people who are funding this fund. Therefore, we should be able to find out whether that fund is really good or not. And at the way it looks now, sir, this fund, well, do your homework.
All right. On that note, I want to thank you so much for joining today, Professor Solita Monsor, also former NEDI secretary. Thank you, ma'am, for joining me. Mag-ingat po kayo. You take care.
Okay. Take care, Karen.